I'm Roger Simpson. I'm a professor of communication. I've been on the University of Washington faculty since 1973. Much of my work is in journalism education, but I also teach other courses in the communication field. The media have always served, when they do their work well, as alarms for us. They tell us there are emergencies or disasters or something to respond to quickly. And my sense is that the media since April, nationally and locally, have been doing a good job of ringing the alarm bell. If you think back to colonial times or the frontier experience, when a fire started or some other kind of disaster occurred, somebody was going to ring that bell loud and clear. And so, to the credit of the news media, it seems to me the bell was rung in mid-April loud and clear, and the evidence is that Americans have responded to that alarm very effectively. The electronic media have placed the user of information, the person seeking information, especially about health topics, I think in a much stronger relationship than has ever been the case. It is now possible for any one of us to go directly to the CDC, and assuming that the CDC is posting the most accurate information available, and I think that's the case, we can know what the CDC knows. We can know what the World Health Organization knows. We can go to the website of the King County Health Department and know what folks downtown understand about this disease. That wasn't the case. We've had two pandemics in the last 60 years prior to this, one in 1957 and one in 1968. In neither of those years was it possible for any of us who were either ill or frightened of becoming ill to go to a national, county, or international agency and learn exactly where things are on this. The news media are giving us some good sources. I recall one day recently when I think one of the newspaper websites listed and provided the links directly to the CDC, to the World Health Organization, to the King County Health Department, to other agencies that have this information. Yes, there are a lot of people contributing their own experiences and reflections and perhaps erroneous observations about things. We do have to use some common sense in sorting out these sources. So I compliment the major media, these fading mainstream media, for at least telling us where to go for the best possible information. But there are no guarantees that we're going to be smart enough to keep our eyes on the right sources. Journalism has an opportunity to recast itself in terms of our major and best source of information about health issues. What it's doing now is focusing on those three most important, in the public mind anyway, diseases: cancer, health disease, diabetes, I think, and perhaps HIV, AIDS is a fourth topic. Health is a broad umbrella that covers many, many, many kinds of personal effects, illnesses, diseases, as well as lifestyle, social relationships, all kinds of things. And if both journalists in training and the journalists in the field had additional resources to focus their attention on that complex area, we would all benefit. But I think the reality is that the industry is losing the capacity to do that. Journalism schools will slowly perhaps respond to that, but not very fast. And so the answer may lie best in public awareness of how to find the right information to deal with particular health and illness issues. There's an emotional side to the swine flu pandemic that we're not paying much attention to. It's not the same as the traumatic stress that I'm more familiar with, where a sudden unexpected event like an earthquake or a car crash kind of affects your brain and nervous ability to respond to incidents. The story of the swine flu pandemic has done something a little different. It's hit the emotion of fear and anxiety, which may be connected to traumatic experiences, but not necessarily. But the news of that possibility has left some people alarmed for themselves, of course, for family members and friends. There is a sense, it appears from surveys, that a high percentage of us expect to have the flu, which is probably unrealistic given past flu experiences. So there's an emotional side to this that we can't address very well. It relates to how much personal support we have within our families, within our network of friends, within our workplaces. It relates to our capacity to share a feeling of that flu is a fairly common thing in life experience, even though this one may be more severe than last year's flu and the year before and so on. So there will be some emotional reactions, and some people will be frightened and some people will be alarmed and exaggerate the potential effects. Some of that is reasonable in view of the threat. Some of it is overstated and overreaction. If you have access to some good information, it will help, but I think I'm not sure that websites always solve the problem of nervous anticipation of something, or fear, or anxiety, or dread, or even something like panic. What we learned in the trauma field is that we survive and emerge from traumatic experiences best if we have support, human support, support from friends, coworkers, family, and so on. And that may be part of the answer in this case, too. If we can help each other kind of not only work our way through, calm ourselves down, be realistic about what is happening, and find some adequate sources of information.